Hello and welcome to the sixth weekend of the PCC Cup Series here at the high banks of Talladega. Gabriel Messina qualifies on the pole. Clara Kindall starts on his outside as we take you through the field. Only 28 cars took time here today. Chris Washer qualified seventh, a very good run for him. He apparently got some decent funding from Red Bull finally, and that car has been bad fast all weekend. As I was saying before, only 28 cars took time for qualifying in race number one, and there's quite a few names, quite a few big names that are starting near the back of the field, so it's going to be interesting to see them try and work their way towards the front. There, Candace Bowman starting in 20th place, working our way back. A couple cars are starting a bit further towards the front than we would have expected. Alex Alenko qualified 25th, his best qualifying effort of his career. John Kirkpatrick qualifies in 28th place. And now we get into the no-time cars. Lars Ryut qualified 29th. All of these cars were set by practice times, and they've been lined up accordingly based on their practice speeds. Going back, a couple really fast cars near the back. Kyle McWalla there, starting in 38th. Ben Worthington and Silvio Rinaldi round out the field for race one. Now in race number two, Joe Craig takes his second pole of the season. Ian Elias on his outside. Stephens Racing occupies row number two. Ben Atkins, your former championship leader, is in row number three. As we keep going through the field, John Jefferson there in eighth place. Only 27 cars took time in the qualifying sessions for this race. And once again, a couple cars that we did not expect to qualify very well are a bit closer to the front and might cause a few issues once the race gets underway, with some of the faster cars trying to weave their way around them. Qualifying times, I believe the pole time had an average speed of 262 miles per hour. It was held during a very cloudy day, and it was quite cold that day, so that might factor into the speeds, but still they're going quite fast here today at Talladega. So it's going to be very interesting to see how the drivers react to these high speeds and see what's going on with how they're handling their cars. A couple of cars were drifting a bit close to the wall when they were doing drafting practice, so it's going to be interesting to also see if they adjust for that and whether or not they hit the wall coming out of turn number two and turn number four. And now Gabriel Messina leads the field to the green flag. The young Brazilian rookie gets a good jump on the inside of Clara Kindall there. Clara Kindall in the one car start on the outside pole. Looks like Preston Bell starting to drop back pretty fast there. But Gabriel Messina, driver of this number 999 Razchem Jaguar, getting a good start here. This is his first career pole in the PCC Cup Series, and it looks like he's doing a pretty good job. Clara Kindall is going to get a run on the inside and take the lead coming into turn number three and sweep around Messina, putting him back a bit further. John Kirkpatrick has already lost the main pack. As you see here, he's quite a bit behind at the end of lap one already. Damon Jones running in the back of the main pack, running a bit high. Something's not right with that car. He's swerving all over the place, and he immediately slows down. Looks like Richard Hurts behind him, Silvio Rinaldi there, making a move on the inside around him. He's going to pull that car to the apron, cut tire on the number 48 car. He's going to put him out of contention early and drop him two laps down as he limps that car back to the pits. Tough break for the DJ Motorsports crew. They were really hoping to have a good run here today. Here's Richard Dean MacGyver having a good, strong run. Tom Delgado hits the wall. He reacts, hits the apron, kicks up some dust there, gets back on track. Oh, he swerves to the left. Think he overreacted to his teammate Stringfellow Vincent being there. And he's still overreacting, hitting the apron and the yellow line. And what is he doing? Swerving all over the place there. Chris Washer now running in second place. That Red Bull money finally came through, apparently, as now he's having the best run of his career. And is right behind Clara Kindall. Looks like we've got a car peeling off there in the background. That's Tom Delgado. Tom Delgado pitting on lap number three along with Isaac Michaels and Preston Bell. These cars are gambling on fuel and going to try and make it the rest of the distance, putting themselves lap down, hoping that this race will go caution-free. Duncan Cobb now moving up. He's running in fifth place right now. He just passed Daniel Sharp to move up to fourth. Kurt Pliskin running in front of him there, driving for Retro 80 Racing, their fourth car, the 81 car. He's doing a great job here today, as well as Daniel Sharp right behind him in that at 0-1 car, starting to drop back a little bit, but still having a good run regardless of that. Here we've got, looks like Candace Bowman having a very strong run today. She's running up in 13th place, doing quite a good job for the motorsports team. She has really not lived up to her potential in the series thus far. She had an 11th place run at Road America that got her in this race, but that was kind of by default, seeing as only about 11 or 10 cars finished that race. But looks like she's really proving her worth here in this car, driving up in the top 15 right now. Luke Pellerin peeling off into the pit lane the next lap. This is lap number 5, and it looks like he's got a little bit of damage on the right side, as if he tagged the wall somewhere. James Hewitt running on the bottom. Ooh, he slowed up there for some reason. Not sure why he did that. But James Hewitt, the model of consistency here in the PCC Cup Series. He was running in 15th place before that, and now he's lost a couple more positions. He's jamming up the inside line. Hewitt, I don't believe, is used to running on tracks this large and this fast, so a little bit of a learning curve for the young Englishman there, getting shuffled out of the way by Ryan Matthews. Scott Wullen is up to second place, having a strong run in this number 16 car, doing a pretty good job. He got around Chris Washer there and has been running up in the main pack all race. Looks like Lenny Jacobs is starting to peel off into the pits as well. Gambling on fuel and trying to stretch it the rest of the way. Pitting off cycle with everyone, or pitting off cycle of everyone else. Looks like Alex Posington is going to do the same thing here the next lap. And I believe this is, that's Kurt Pliskin getting a good push on the inside by Duncan Cobb, going around, looks like Lewis Jones and Daniel Sharp to move up to third place. So Kurt Pliskin having a very strong run in this 81 car, the fourth Retro 80 Racing car. They've split their seven-car team, so they've got 3 cars running in Europe and 4 cars running here. So that should be putting a strain on their resources, but it doesn't seem to be affecting them quite as much as we were expecting. Here's John Kirkpatrick getting ready to go a lap down on lap number 9, so that tells you how slow his day has been. So there goes Clara Kindall on the inside, but he's actually being a pretty decent backmarker today, staying out of everyone's way, really just riding the high line. I'm actually quite impressed by how he's doing here so far. John Kirkpatrick, not really know what are you doing. He just swung down and blocked Ryan Matthews. Here's your points leader, Stringfellow Vincent, running up in the top 10 and fighting his way up towards the top 5 right now. So Stringfellow Vincent trying to defend his points lead by running very strong. He's moved up to third place now on the inside there with Daniel Sharp and looks like Chris Washer, Lewis Jones right behind him, Brian Gallagher in front. Silvio Rinaldi started in last place, is now up to 17th place on lap number 12. So that tells you how her day's been, moving up really fast. There you see she just took a couple more cars on the outside. Scott Wullen here having a good run. Looks like he's going to peel off and get into the pits because this fuel canister that they've got in the car does not exactly hold enough fuel to make them to make the cars go to the end of the race. Here's Laris Riu, your second place car in points, and she's kind of struggling here today. Not really running quite as well as Stringfellow Vincent. Clara Kindall now running up front. See there, Silvia Rinaldi really making a move. Oh, looks like she's going to pass for second place now. So Silvia Rinaldi joining her Manticore teammate up there, and she is coming fast and in a hurry. You can see there she made a pass on Brian Gallagher, and the next lap she's caught right up to her and going to draft down in turn number 3, turn number 4, and Silvia Rinaldi takes the lead here on lap number 15. So now with Rinaldi in the lead, oh, looks like we've got Klaus Muck coming out of Clara Kindall. Your former leader has just blown up. Something is definitely wrong with that car. Pulls the car to the inside, blocks Brian Gallagher, swerving that car, trying to figure out what's wrong with it. Unfortunately, Clara Kindall is going to be the first retirement of the race. Very unfortunate for her. And she is going to finish 40th here today. Damon Jones struggling a little bit here in this number 48 car. Something's still not right with that car. He's quite a bit off the pace. Trying to pick a line, Chris Washer almost hits the wall there, and he's not being a very gracious backmarker at all. Ooh, Candace Bowman is up in the top five now after that. So a very strong run for Candace Bowman here today as Damon Jones continues to slide back. Kyle McWalla now has emerged as a contender, and he's drafting right up to Silvio Rinaldi. As you see our nice little graphic on the left there, we just upgraded our graphics department a little bit, so hope you guys appreciate that. That's your hard-earned tax dollars going to work there. Kyle McWalla doing a good job here today. Brian Matthews having a very strong run in this number 02 car, and he's doing a good job. It's the first time I believe that both motorsports team cars are running in undamaged, I should mention, in the top 20. They were both running in the top 20 at Road America, but both were damaged quite a bit. Both doing a very good job here today. Ryan Matthews really pushing forward, and he's putting himself in a good spot to transfer into race number one next week. Laris Riu now moving up to third place. You've got Cameron Taylor and Chris Washer right behind her. Laris Riu, your second place driver in points. And if she keeps up a run like this, she might be able to take the points lead away from Stringfellow Vincent. And we'll keep you posted on that. Candace Bowman running in the back here. Oh, something's not right with that car. She's slowing down. Gonna pull that car down. Unfortunate for her. She was having quite a strong run. Blocks Gabriel Messina, the pole sitter there, and Nick Azure. As she pulls her car into the pits, it would turn out to be a cut tire. She'd get back going without too much of a hitch. Looks like Silvio Rinaldi coming up to lap John Kirkpatrick again. There's Kyle McWalla right behind her. And Laris Riu catches up there. You get a little bit of distance now between Kyle McWalla. Hopefully his car will cool down. He's been reporting some overheating issues in that number 12 car. Really trying to stay up with Silvio Rinaldi, but her car seems unbeatable on these super speedways. They've taped that car up, the 12 car, to really try and so he can hold his own with Rinaldi there. As you can see, just the distance that she's put on McWalla. Oh, looks like McWalla's car has gone up in smoke. His overheating issues, unfortunately, got the better of him, as he really just wanted to try and stay up with Rinaldi. But unfortunately, too much grill tape means you're going to fall by the wayside pretty quickly. So, kind of sucks for you. Here's Chris DeSanta. Unfortunately for him, he is being the fertilizer in the 10th paradigm as he goes lap down here. Chris DeSanta recently opened a new Epsilon temple in Talladega, so it's going to be interesting to see that evolve. Roy Cook has a problem here, and he's going to pull that car to the apron. Suspension problems in the number 22 car are going to force him to park that car, get towed back to the pits, and he's going to lose five laps in the process in that number 22 car. He would get that car back going and get back on the track, however. A little later on, Josh Marshall looks like he's going to hit the wall there. He was running in the lead pack. Brian Gallagher gets out of the way. Josh Marshall has quite a bit of damage on the right side of that car now. He was doing a good job. He was running up in about 15th place or so, but the damage on the right side of that car is going to put a hamper on his day and unfortunately take him out of contention. So now Laris Riu has inherited second place from the rather exploded Kyle McWalla. Looks like, she's got a problem there with that car. She's slowing down. She's reporting that it's a soft right front tire. Duncan Cobb goes by, and here comes the rest of the pack. Lewis Jones goes by, Richard Dean MacGyver, Ryan Matthews, and the rest of the pack, aside from a few cars that she slowed up on the high side. Kurt Pliskin there, Daniel Sharp, and Chris Washer, among others. She's going to bring that car into the pits, get that tire changed out, and she's going to fall one lap down in doing so. Fortunately for her, she will stay in the race. Silvio Rinaldi now has pulled out to an absolutely massive lead over Duncan Cobb and Lewis Jones, the rest of the top three back there. Silvio Rinaldi, however, lap 31 of 76, she's reporting that she's going to bring her car into the pits. So she's going to do that one lap early and try and roll the dice and see what she can do in the pit lane. Manticore Engineering says that they can pit their cars faster than everyone else, so here they're going to prove it. Duncan Cobb, the unlikely championship contender now, takes over the lead, driving the number 70 for Clayson Enterprises. Duncan Cobb has had a rather surprising year. He's been in contention most of the weeks, surprisingly. Lewis Jones there in second, trying to draft up. But Duncan Cobb really doing quite an excellent job here, and he's going to get a bonus point for leading this lap. And he's going to stay out. Looks like a couple other cars might be peeling into the pits. We're going to go back and check on that for you. Here's Ryan Matthews, who's done an excellent job as well. Moved up to third place, drafting with everyone else. He's got a group of Brian Gallagher, Cameron Taylor, Richard Dean MacGyver, and Stringfellow Vincent behind him. And they're going to catch up to this main pack here of Duncan Cobb and Lewis Jones just in time for... They're still not pitting. I could have sworn they were going to pit that time by. Excuse me for that. Actually, we did have a car pit. Looks like can't tell if that's the 78 of Greg Maddux. I believe it is. Nick Azure and Ryan Griffin and Alex Alenko and Jordan Demas bring their car into the pits. Next lap, it looks like Lewis Jones, Brian Gallagher, and a couple other cars, Cameron Taylor there, and Richard Dean MacGyver, and Daniel Sharp all bring their cars into the pits that lap. And looks like the lap after that, we're going to get Duncan Cobb, the leader, Stringfellow Vincent, and pretty much the rest of the leaders are going to bring their cars into the pits, and pit cycle is going to cycle out. Gabriel Messina is going to stay out one extra lap and lead a lap that he was planning on leading before he got passed by Clara Kendall. So Gabriel Messina finally gets his lap led. Messina here coming around. I believe he's going to be the last car to complete the pit cycle. So we're just waiting for him to come in here. It's either him or actually him and Lenny Jacobs back there. I think Lenny Jacobs hasn't pit yet. I'm not sure. He may have. He may have not. I'll double-check the scoring next time by. Yes, Lenny Jacobs has indeed pit that car. I just remember that he was one of the cars that did an off-cycle pit earlier on, and that's why he inherited the lead. So Lenny Jacobs' strategy is paying off. I believe Scott Wallen behind him, that is... he is also racing him for position in second place, so they really... their gamble really paid off. Luke Pellerin, they're about to go two laps down. So that tells you how nightmarish his day's been. Here's third and fourth with Brian Gallagher and Lewis Jones running quite a ways back, about two or so seconds away from the rest of the field. And here's Silver Rinaldi and the rest of the main pack running about a second or two behind them. So pit stops have really spread everyone out. But it looks like everyone's going to accordion their way back together here relatively shortly. Looks like here... we've got some lap traffic. There's Josh Marshall, Laris Ryu, as Lenny Jacobs and Scott Wallen start to slice their way through that. Lenny Jacobs, the super speedway expert, as he pegs himself, has really not had a great season. He's trying to get something going, but engine unreliability and just plain bad luck have just struck him down pretty much every week. Looks like Damon Jones just came out of the pits, merging up in front of Gabriel Messina, and what are you doing? Caution 1 would fly on lap number 42 for the boneheaded Damon Jones, swerving up in front of the pole sitter Gabriel Messina, and here comes Chris Winter, and that's going to end both of their days. Chris Winter and all cars involved would go out of the race. You see there, Gabriel Messina pulled the... tried to give him room, but Damon Jones just kept coming up. Unfortunately, that would do suspension damage to the 999 car, and obviously the 56 and 48 cars would both go out of the race after this incident. All of the leaders, except for Scott Wallen, would come into the pits under the caution. Looks like Stringfellow Vince is going to have some brake issues, and he would retire from the race after that. So your points leader is out of the event early on, and under caution, Lewis Jones also suffered a clutch failure in that number 9 car, so that's going to take him out of the race from a potentially contending position. Scott Wallen stayed out for two laps and got some bonus points, and he's going to bring his car into the pits and file back to the end of the longest line. You see here, Silvio Rinaldi takes the lead again. Ryan Matthews is up to fourth place in that number 02 car. He's running in fourth place. Eric Hindall is out of the race, as you see there in 40th. So Silvio Rinaldi trying to avenge her fallen Manticore teammate and really try and secure a good finish for the entire operation. Laris Riu now trying to make her way up, and she is the first car one lap down, and she's leading the pack behind Silvio Rinaldi there. So really having a strong run. Unfortunately, she's a lap down, so she doesn't have the position to show for it. But Laris Riu having a very strong run here today, despite being a lap down. So she's really hoping she can get her lap back. Now Ben Worthington, after all of this, after the caution and bunching of the field, he suddenly comes into contention. So he's had, that was probably not the best thing ever. He goes through the apron, kicks up dust, and he comes out in front of the pack. He got hooked there by Lenny Jacobs and somehow hung on to it. We're going to go on board with Lenny Jacobs here and see what he saw. Looks like a bad bump gone wrong here. Ooh, yes. He caught the quarter panel there. And fortunately for Worthington, he hung on to the car and got a nice speed boost out of that. So that's good news for him. Here's Ryan Griffin having a decent run as well. He's running up in the top 15. And he's going to start dropping back a little bit here. But Ryan Griffin having a good run as well. Haven't really talked much about him. He was running way in the back, kind of separate from everyone else. But he's managed to work his way back up towards the front. Cale Bernhardt Jr. turns John Bracci, and looks like a multi-car incident has erupted there. Lap number 52, caution 2. Brian Gallagher hit the wall head-on at 215 miles per hour, unsure of his medical condition. Hewitt was also involved, going on board with Ryan Griffin to see what he saw there. He gets a little bit of damage. Fortunately for him, it wouldn't be too severe. Only him and Hewitt would continue on. As you see here, John Bracci, and that was a huge hit for Brian Gallagher in that number 47 car. I hope that he's okay, or at least is semi-conscious. So on the restart, Silvio Rinaldi leads over Lenny Jacobs and Cameron Taylor. And looks like we missed Jordan Demas dropping out. He had an engine problem in that number 74 car that caused him to drop out right before the first caution. Now, Candace Bowman has worked her way back onto lead lap, but unfortunately, while running 11th, she's going to suffer even more problems that are going to take her ultimately out of the race. So a tough break for Candace Bowman in the 20 car. She was having a very strong run, but unfortunately, it wasn't meant to be. Now, Ryan Matthews, her teammate, is going to try to avenge her. And, he's up in 5th place, so I guess you can say that he's doing that with his run right now, having a very strong run in this number 02 car, second strong run in as many weeks. Roy Cook, running 6 laps down, is going to have a problem with that number 22 car, and swerving all over the place, and he takes out Richard Dean MacGyver. Way to go, Roy Cook. You really probably should not have been on the track in the first place. Fortunately for Roy Cook, and unfortunately for the rest of the field, he would continue on. Richard Dean MacGyver would suffer some damage. Silvio Rinaldi continues to lead over the rest of the field, pulling quite a bit away from them, and really just doing a hell of a job. Alex Alenko has somehow kept his car on the lead lap. He's running in 13th place. He hasn't been in any of the shots because he's always been in a little group of cars right behind the main pack. You see right there, the main pack. Alex Alenko staying out of trouble early on and throughout the majority of this race trying to get out of trouble. James Hewitt is slower than John Kirkpatrick and is a pretty bad back marker, as you see here, trying to hang on to the bottom. And fortunately, all the cars are aware of his existence and pass him on the high side, trying to stay low for cars. Cameron Taylor, we haven't talked about him all day. He's moved up to 3rd place. Laris Riu there. Second car in line is a lap down. trying to make her way back onto the lead lap still. Cameron Taylor having a strong run in third place behind Lenny Jacobs there. Here's Chris Washer and Ryan Matthews, and they were having a good run. They were running in fourth and fifth, but they lost the pack due to James Hewitt's incompetence. But now they've been caught by the rest of the pack here. I believe these are cars that are running 5th through 12th or so. Ryan Matthews there in a 4-wide situation. Looks like Richard Hertz hits the wall. Ryan Matthews hits the apron, and he gets turned by Preston Bell at the line. Caution number 3 on lap 72, and Ryan Matthews is done for the day. Unfortunately, sliding up the track, sliding down, there's Luke Pellerin, and oh, Roy Cook hits him. And Roy Cook goes flipping down the track. He got hit by Kurt Pliskin, and we've got some automotive gymnastics. Duncan Cobb with the avoidance of the day here. It gets turned by Preston Bell. Ooh, there's Ryan Matthews, and he continues on. Checks up. Very good avoidance by Duncan Cobb there. Going to transition to Roy Cook's view, and Ryan Matthews had one hell of a ride there, and Roy Cook has even more of a ride as he goes over multiple times and over Ryan Matthews. Here's Kurt Pliskin, and you just see there he hits Roy Cook in the side, and Roy Cook goes barrel rolling and over the top of Ryan Matthews, ending all of their days. Under caution, this would bring out caution with just a few laps to go. The race would finish under caution, but Silvio Rinaldi ran out of fuel on the last lap while leading. While setting up for a green-white checkered. So Silvio Rinaldi would ultimately make the green-white checkered, as would Lars Riu, but both of them would start in the back of the pack. 14 cars would take finish on the lead lap, with Cameron Taylor leading the field to the checkered flag for regulation, setting up a 14-car two-lap dash to the checkers in a green-white checkered. Cameron Taylor leads the field to the green flag of the green-white checkered. No cautions in this green-white checkered attempt, so checkers are wreckers, basically. Checkers and wreckers, I should say. Chris Washer makes a move on the inside there in the number 906 Red Bull car, and he's going to pull away from the field. Looks like we've got a couple cars off in the back. There was Ryan Griffin. Alex Alenko moves up now. Looks like Ben Worthington trying to get a good push on the bottom there. Chris Washer, you see there in the lead. Ben Worthington getting a push from Silvio Rinaldi. And, oh, all five cars get hooked. And there's a huge crash coming out of turn four. We got a car in the catch fence. A couple cars flipping. And Chris Washer is the only car not involved in that accident, basically handing this win to Chris Washer, of all people. Chris Washer, he who seemingly showed up out of nowhere with no money, is going to win a PCC Cup Series race. I am speechless. How the hell did this happen? Seriously, Chris Washer is winning a PCC Cup Series race because everyone crashed like fools on the last lap. Chris Washer, coming through the tri-oval, will take the win in race number one at Talladega. Now we're going to go on board with Ryan Griffin here. Let's see what happened there. Oh, looks like Alex Alenko just got a little speed boost from getting hooked by Ryan Griffin. No big deal there. But here is the real fun. Silvio Rinaldi gets hooked, and at the same time, Greg Maddux hooked Daniel Sharp, who goes into the catch fence. Looks like we had a couple spinners up there. Silvio Rinaldi's car is done, as is most of the field, going slow-mo here. You see, she got hooked by Duncan Cobb at the same time that she hooked Ben Worthington, and Maddux hooked. Oh boy, this is just an absolute mess. Cameron Taylor saves the car there, and Nick Azur comes in full bore and runs into, I believe that was Alex Alenko, who had managed to get by everything. So a huge incident all around. Every single car was involved, except for Chris Washer. Going on board with Nick Azur there, Scott Wallen hit the wall. He would eventually drop out of the race due to some crash damage that you see there. He tried to go for it, but Alex Alenko had slowed down, and Azur didn't, so he piled right into that. Going on board Cameron Taylor here, and saves the car and gets hit by Lars Riu there. He would continue on and eventually actually finish second place, going on board third place finisher Alex Alenko. You see there, got just a little bit of damage and may have finished second place if it wasn't for that. But he would soldier on, bring the car home, and do a good job with that team. Richard Dean MacGyver, a very scary incident there. He gets launched across the track and hit by Scott Wullen, and his day would end, unsure of his medical condition. And this tells all from the back bumper of Chris Washer, as you just see the entire field get wiped out there. Now let's take you to the results. As mentioned before, Chris Washer wins here today in the joke of the century, as this is the ultimate fluke win in PCC Cup Series history, the biggest upset I've ever seen, and I doubt he'll be able to repeat it ever again. So much for that. Enjoy it while you can, Chris Washer, because I really don't think this is going to happen again. Cameron Taylor passed Alex Alenko for second place after both were involved in an accident late, after the massive accident that eliminated many cars and threw them into the catch fence. Lars Ryu and Ryan Griffin would cross the line, but unfortunately their cars would give up before they completed the second lap of the Green-White-Checkered. Scott Wullen did not complete two laps. He only completed one lap in the Green-White-Checkered. Duncan Cobb got brutally murdered, as did Greg Maddox. Daniel Sharp ate the catch fence for breakfast. Richard Dean MacGyver got destroyed. Ben Worthington got stuck in the outside wall and proceeded to get thrown across the track. Lenny Jacobs did not have a fun day at all. Neither did Nick Azure or Silvio Rinaldi, as all of them promptly got severely murdered to death in the Green-White-Checkered. 15th through 20th did not make the Green-White-Checkered and were lucky to escape with their lives. Tom Delgado was the first car one lap down when the Green-White-Checkered began. So he did not take the Green-White-Checkered. Isaac Michaels, his pit strategy kind of worked out and finished in 16th place. Preston Bell finished in 17th. Alex Pausington, 18th. And Chris DeSanta, pleasing Kraft in 19th place. There is a 9 there, 9th Paradigm, doing quite a good job for Kraft and his brother Uncle. And James Hewitt, despite being destroyed, finishes in 20th place. And we'll move on to race number one at the track after Mansfield. After cleaning the bodies off of the track from race one, race two would begin, but only 39 cars would take the green flag, as Creeper Stevenson suffered some engine problems during the pace lap and pulled his car into the pits. But Joe Craig would bring the field to the green flag. Ian Elias on his outside, but Joe Craig gets a good start. Everyone behind them apparently doesn't. Barbara Burt already going three wide there on the outside. Falling back pretty fast. Joe Craig leads the field through turn number two coming out, and we've got some problems in the back there. Caution number one would fly on the first lap of the race. Barbara Burt goes high, trying to stay out of the groove, hits the outside wall, bounces down the track. Looks like Lena Lazareva, Alex Phillips, and Magenta Nelson Andrew were all collected, but surprisingly, no damage would come from this. We're going to get another view from a helicopter here, and you see there she sweeps down into Lazareva. Phillips spins around, and so does Andrew, but she saves it, going on board with Barbara Burt here. She started pretty well, but unfortunately with this incident, she's going to drop back quite a bit in the pack. You see there, nobody really gets involved, so a bit surprising. Green flag would fly on lap number five. Joe Craig continues to lead, as not too many positions have changed. You can see there on the left-hand side, we've got the running order for you. Aucier, Corradovo's not having good runs early on. They haven't really been able to advance their position much. They both started way back in the field, and they're currently running 38th and 39th. This is Sam Lussard, who's diving into the pits, hoping that the rest of the race will go green to the end, trying to gamble on some strategy, pulling into the pits early on. Looks like Ian Elias now making a move for the lead on Joe Craig, and this just tells you how much more competitive this race is than the last one. Because the last race only had, I believe, 7 lead changes from 7 drivers, and here we're already having our second lead change of the race, as Ian Elias takes over the top spot and is starting to pull away from Joe Craig. There you see, looks like Barry Juveneau is running in third place, and Joe Craig is going to take the lead back. So really good racing up near the front. Ben Atkins having a good run as well, trying to capitalize on gaining some points back. Ingrid Hadeland's up there. Got quite a bit of cars. Some of us are coming out of the pits. Matt Brinson is losing the pack right now on lap number 8. He's running in 37th place. He just passed Samusar for, he just put Samusar a lap down, but he has already lost the pack, struggling a bit here today. Timmy Cook got a bit of front-end damage under the caution. I believe he ran into a car as they were taking the yellow flag, and he's dropping back slowly but surely in this number 40 car for Triple XXX Racing. Joe Craig now continuing to lead. Looks like we've got a battle back there between Stefan's racing teammates. Looks like there's Barry Juveno, Chris Benson, and Kenny Stephens are running in the top four. Here comes Tom Wilson, it looks like, on the inside. Tom Wilson having a good run. But Joe Craig, Petrol-Tech Engineering, is known for their prowess on the super speedways. And all the way back to 2011, back when they were Raptor Racing, they were always very strong on these super speedways. So Joe Craig continuing to show good form. Looks like, I believe this is the 88 of Jacob Eichholz coming in on lap 10. He suffered a puncture on that car. Tom Wilson scrapes against the wall, and he's going to drop back a little bit. Tom Wilson, the championship caliber test driver, as he described himself last year, has not had a good season. He's not doing very well, and unfortunately, his skills as a championship caliber test driver have not transcended into a full-time, into a successful full-time career. He drops back to the back of the pack. Ian Elias makes another move, and as you can see there, Daniel Ecklater has logged onto Skype in his car somehow. I'm not sure how he did that. But here comes Gaspar D'Souza now coming up towards the front of the field. Looks like he's going to try and get around Ian Elias for the lead. Getting good push from Ingrid Hadeland, but Hadeland dives low. Looks like D'Souza is going to hook up with his teammate there on the outside, Joe Craig, and they're going to tango. Oh no, they're not. Looks like he's going to get shuffled out to the high side. So Joe Craig and Gaspar D'Souza not really working together today. Ingrid Hadeland getting a push from John Jefferson in the Triple XXX Racing team. There on the high side, Triple XXX Racing back after some internal problems put them out for another race. They weren't at Road America, but not really sure what's going on with that team. They haven't been very vocal about what they're doing or what's been keeping them from getting to the track. Ingrid Hadeland continuing to lead. Dan Branch's car has been jacked up in the pits like this for the past lap or so, so it's safe to assume that they're having some problems. I don't see them getting back out on the track anytime soon. Here's Denny Adams as Kenny Stephens hits the wall in the background. Denny Adams moving up to third place now, giving Claire Aussier a shove towards the lead. Very good battle up front. A lot of cars are swapping positions up here, swapping the lead. And looks like it's going to continue this way. Ryan Jeffries now making an appearance up near the front. Haven't seen too much of him all day. But looks like Denny Adams has taken the lead, and John Jefferson now is bringing his car into the pits. I believe he tagged the wall. Unfortunate for the Triple XXX Racing team. They're having a good, strong run today, and that's going to be a damper on their day. Cody Deke hits the outside wall, driving the 31 again this year, and he's going to drop to the back of the pack and get stuck on the wall as if it's made of glue. He's going to drop that back there with his teammate Alex Phillips. Unfortunately, he hasn't had a good year either. Ben Atkins now up to third place, and he's really hoping to gain some ground in the championship battle. He came into Road America as the championship leader and had led for a few weeks before having an accident at Road America that put him quite down in the standings. And he's really hoping that this run here can boost his chances of getting back into the championship running. I believe he fell down to around 9th or 10th. Here's Les Jackson driving the 11 car. The fifth Johnson Racing entry for this race, and he's having a strong run. He's up in the top 15, doing a pretty job here. Pretty good job here, lap number 19 of 76, and he's slowly been working his way back up towards the front. Matt Brinson now, and Magenta Nelson Andrew going a lap down. Cody Deke up there pit a few laps ago. Ian Elias goes by, and Matt Brinson's going to stay close to the wall, actually. He's going to be a good back marker. He learned from the ways of John Kirkpatrick, apparently, and is staying up near the front, up near the top of the wall. Ike Durbin, one of your championship contenders, I believe he's second or third in the championship right now, is fourth in the championship, is hanging near the back of this pack, trying to stay out of trouble, drafting with, I believe that's Nelson Andrew there. Gaspar de Souza hooks up with Joe Craig on the bottom, and they're going to go up to second place. They've always done this at Talladega and Daytona and those kinds of tracks, and they're forcing their way towards the front. Joe Craig abandons. Gaspar de Souza. De Souza slid up a bit and is going to ride the high groove now, and Joe Craig is going to try and take over the lead, and he's going to do so. On the bottom there, away from Ian Elias, brings along Alina Lazareva, among others. Gaspar de Souza starts to fall back to the back of the pack. Lap 23, and Barry Juvenile is having a very strong run, pushing Casey Lester there. He dives to the apron, puts two tires below the yellow line, and we are four wide here on lap number 24. Barry Juvenile forcing it on the bottom of Casey Lester, Ingrid Hadland, and Alina Lazareva. Lazareva hits the wall there. Ben Atkins slides up a little bit, still four wide. Atkins hits the wall again, swings down. Ryan Jeffries involved. Looks like Greg Woodard as well, going on board with Jeffries here. And Lazareva hits the wall there. He's riding along. And there's Ben Atkins. And looks like Jeffries went for a spin. And Atkins has some rear-end damage. He clipped the inside wall there. Tough break for Ben Atkins. He was having such a good run and really hoping to do what he could in the championship battle, but he's trying a little too hard there. Hits the wall, clips Hadland, hits the wall again, swings down into Jeffries, and I believe that's Greg Woodard as well. And that's going to be a lot of damage to that 5 car. Unfortunately for him, he's going to bring that car into the pits and lose multiple laps in the process getting that car repaired. He would stay out on track. You see there, he bounced into Hadland and came down the track just trying to regain control. Hits the inside wall there, and just a tough break for Ben Atkins, who is undoubtedly going to lose some spots in the championship standings here. Ian Elias brings his car into the pits, suffering from a cut tire. He ran over some debris from that incident and just wanted to make sure that tire wasn't going flat. He felt it a bit soft on the right front. Casey Lester now is up in the top 10. Casey Lester having a very strong run here today and really trying to do what he can to get into race one in the upcoming races. Talladega will not have race one or race two as it is an overcapacity event. Denny Adams having a strong run once again at the front of the field on a super speedway. DJ Motorsports has really geared themselves toward these super speedways and has done quite well all season on them, but Aussie now making a look on the inside. Aussie having her first good run all season, it seems, takes over the lead. Here's Kelly Blackwater, who's had some problems all race with that car, and those problems are going to get worse and are going to be terminal as suspension problems take Kelly Blackwater in the 35 car out of the race here on lap number 26. Tough break for Blackwater, although she wasn't running particularly well at the time. She had lost the pack despite starting near the front. Billy Ray James now on lap number 28. Looks like Dan Branch up there finally got his car out of pits, and Sam Lussar are all about to go at least one lap down. I believe it's two or three in the case of Dan Branch, but Billy Ray James got his start driving for JK Racing at Charlotte, won the Owners' Championship for the 11 car, and now Circle Track Racing has picked him up full-time as he's bringing Billy Beer money to that car. Staying on the high side and getting out of everyone's way. Barry Juvenile, one of the worst full-time drivers this year so far, takes the lead, surprisingly, gets stuck in the middle, got a little bit of four wide there with Ingrid Hadland, Aussie, and Dan Branch, and they wisely back out of that, but Dan Branch stuck on the high side there, and looks like Sam Lussar got hooked by Aussie, not too happy with Lussar there, but Lussar is going to hang on. And he has not been a very good backmarker today. He blocked Barry Juvenile from taking the lead, as you saw in that previous shot there. Here's Andy Lambert, teammate to Kelly Blackwater, who is not reporting any suspension damage and is soldiering on near the back of the lead pack in 11th place. Nicholas Corradovos now is leading the second pack back here. These cars are running about 18th, 19th place or so back here, and just trying to hang on, hoping for a caution sometime later in the event. Green flag pit stops are kicking off as the majority of the lead pack brings their car into the pits. You see there, we've got two and two wide back there, but Joe Craig leads the this big group of cars into the pits. Denny Adams continues to stay out and will continue to lead. Denny Adams staying out, and he's done a really good job today. I wouldn't be surprised to see Denny Adams near the front at the end of this event, challenging for the win. He's had a rocket ship of a car today. Most of the other cars are bringing their cars into the pits. I think we may have one or two cars that have stayed out. Gonna go and check for you. Yes, Corradovo's has stayed out, drafting there with Matt Brinson, and Corradovo's is going to take over the lead and get a bonus point or two. Corradovo's is not in the top 20 in points. I believe he's 26th or 27th right now, and he's really trying to poke his head back up into the top 20 and become a championship contender again, as he won the championship last season. Corradovo's brings his pit in, brings his car into the pits the next lap, lap number 37 of 76. And pit cycle has given Gaspar D'Souza the lead. So Gaspar D'Souza there, Denny Adams on the bottom taking over the lead. They're running two wide, and they have been swapping the lead each lap, so they're not doing themselves any favors. Casey Lester had a surprisingly good pit stop and is in fifth place now behind Aussier there and Ingrid Hadeland. So props to Casey Lester's pit crew for getting him out in a reasonable time, more than reasonable. He's catching Hadeland and Aussier there. Tom Wilson is having a strong run as well. He's up in 12th place after hitting the wall. He's done a good job getting that car back up towards the front and is running in a second pack here of cars from 6th to 12th. Aussier and Hadeland now are catching the two leaders, Denny Adams and Gaspar D'Souza, up there by half a second a lap because they've been constantly swapping the lead back and forth. That's not the smartest thing that they could have done, but Aussier and Hadeland are gaining and gaining fast. As you see here, Adams and D'Souza are swapping the lead once again, and they're running too wide, and you can see there now Hadeland and Aussier have swept into the picture, and they're definitely catching them a lot faster than we expected. Now that they've got the draft, they should catch them within the lap, and that's not good news for Adams or D'Souza. As they swap the lead again, here comes Aussier on the bottom taking over second place, and she's coming for the lead. Aussier having a very strong run today, uncharacteristic of her this year. She has been the epitome of bad luck and has not had anything to show all season. Ben Atkins struggling mightily here today. He's in 38th place. He's got rear end damage and he's about three laps down right now. So he's kind of just soldiering around now, trying to get his car just home to the finish. Here's the 55 car of Chris Benson running in fifth place. They caught Casey Lester and passed him. He's got his teammate Barry Juvenile right behind him. Denny Adams is not in this pack. Joe Craig was what I meant to say. Sorry. Denny Adams is losing this pack, though, as Gaspar D'Souza now is encountering lap traffic. See here, we've got banner there for you of how these cars are running right now. Looks like Aussier got caught up in some lap traffic as threading the needle three wide there with Jacob Eichholz and Dan Branch on the bottom. Cody Deek just went a lap down. Looks like Magenta Nelson Andrew went a lap down as well. Barbara Burt slows on the back stretch. She's got problems in that number 366 car, and I think that was brought upon by her hitting the wall very early on. Something might have broken, it just progressively got worse, and that's going to take her out of the race here on lap number 47. So tough break for the 366 team. They are hoping for a good run. Alex Phillips now is slowing on the backstretch, and he's got a problem that's going to take him out of the race here just a couple laps later on lap number 54 of 76. He was running pretty well. He was running up in the top 15. Alex Phillips, one of the rookies this year, just hasn't had the luck to show for his good performances. He nearly won the PCC Lights Championship last year, but lost it to Kyle McWalla in the last race at Cleveland. He's going to bring his car into the pits and retire it. Tough break for all of Johnson Racing this year. They just have not had the performance to show for the funding that they have. And Kenny Steffens is going to have a problem as well from the top 10. And just a tough break for Kenny Steffens. He was really, really hoping for a good run today to hope to capitalize on his championship run. He was sixth in the championship coming into this race. And as you can see here, that is unfortunately not going to be the case leaving this race. Gaspar D'Souza loses the lead to Denny Adams, and Aussier has caught up again. Hadeland there running in fourth place, always staying in the back, letting the leaders sort out and trying to capitalize on a mistake. But D'Souza falls back to third place now. and he is really trying to get up towards the front there. Looks like we've got the 26 of Ryan Jeffries hitting the pit lane with a cut right front tire. Right front tires are going seemingly randomly on these cars due to the high speeds. They're approaching 260 miles per hour in the turns at the end of the straight. Oh, we've got two cars into the wall there. Looks like we had Ramsey Cochiner and Tom Wilson. We're going to take a look at and see what happened here. It looks like Wilson goes low and got into the wall there, got into the rear quarter panel, and they save it. So they continue on, and Tom Wilson and Cochiner will continue on without too much of a problem. Dan Lechleiter here is going a lap down on lap number 68 of 76. He was on the lead lap, but unfortunately lost the pack to some of the lapped cars. Looks like Aussie is coming into the pits. Aussie is coming into the pits, and so is Lechleiter on lap number 68 of 76. They tried to gamble on fuel, but unfortunately were unable to make it. We've got a couple other cars. Looks like Alina Lazareva and Tom Wilson are all pitting here on lap number 68 of 76, trying to make it to the end. Gaspar D'Souza brings it in. So does Hadland and a lot of the lead pack there. The second lead pack, we've got Denny Adams now staying out and holding on to the lead. Lap number 71 of 76, just five laps to go. And this is a development. They really were not expecting this, but Denny Adams is bringing his car into the pits now. Denny Adams is surrendering the lead to whoever I believe is not pitting. However, taking a look back here, Corey Dovo is the only driver who stayed out. Last pit cycle is coming in the same lap, so that's going to hand the lead over to Gaspar D'Souza, who has a pretty big lead now over the rest of the field. There's Hadland and Aussie behind him there, and they're about 2 seconds or so behind, so this race is Gaspar D'Souza's to lose. Either he's going to lose it or a caution's going to come out, which I don't believe is likely. However, last race we did have an accident that occurred at the very end of pit cycles, but if Gaspar D'Souza wins, it would be his first win in 3 years in this series. He's been racing in this series since 2011 and had a couple close calls at winning, especially Dwyer 2011 comes to mind, a couple other Super Speedway races, and he just continues to lead here. Two laps to go, coming into the trial, we're getting ready to take the white flag, and there is a caution on the track. Caution number two, lap 75. As they were coming to take the white flag, a heartbreak for Gaspar D'Souza as he's going to have to survive a green-white checkered to make it his first career victory. There you see they pick up the pace car, and pace car is going to have to catch up there. Taking a look what happened here, Chris Benson slows. Looks like he's got a problem with that car. Trying to get his way to the apron in the middle of the pack, and he tries to slow up, and there's a chain reaction behind him. Looks like Les Jackson and Tom Wilson were involved going on board with Les Jackson here in the 11 car, and they just tried to slow up and unfortunately didn't use the brakes and were unable to do so. So Les Jackson is going to go out of the race, as is Tom Wilson here, very late in the going, setting up a green-white checkered. 14 cars will advance to the green-white checkered, all the cars that were on the lead lap at the time of the checkered flag for regulation distance. Speaking of the checkered flag, here comes Gaspar D'Souza to take it and end the regulation distance of this race. 14 cars, all of the cars on the lead lap at the end of the race, will advance to the green-white checkered, and we'll be able to see if Gaspar D'Souza can hang on and take his first career victory now. You see there, they brought the field down to the green flag, flying start, and we've already got some contact in the back, some smoke, and all of the cars appear to be involved in a fender bender, except for Gaspar D'Souza. D'Souza continues on through turns 2 and 3. D'Souza now pulling away from Hadland, who appears to be the only car that got away with some speed from that accident. And looks like D'Souza is going to take his first career victory here. The young Portuguese driver, he came over to the States in early 2011, drove for Magic Mopar Racing, the since defunct Magic Mopar Racing, at Road Atlanta in 2011, got a shot with Raptor Racing in 2011, replacing the deceased Jean-François Davila, and since then he has done a remarkable job at the team, brought aboard some funding, and his resume is impressive. However, it does not include a win. Today, though, coming through turn three, it looks like Gaspar D'Souza is going to add a victory to his resume here. Into the trioval, there's some smoke there from a previous accident. Gonna take a look at that later on. But Gaspar D'Souza, first career victory here today at Talladega in race number two, Green White Checkered. He survived the mayhem. And here's what happened. Casey Lester got a shove from Denny Adams. A bunch of cars involved. Minor fender bender. Most of them continue on without too much of a problem. I think Corradovo's was the only one who went out. Aussier went out as well. Going on board with Frank Azzaretto there, got a shove. Looks like Corradovo's almost went over. I believe that was Corradovo's or Barry Juveno. It was Juveno, I think. Aussier's car spewing smoke there, continuing on. Ike Durbin would get through this without too much of a problem. He gets banged around a little bit, continues on, slows down there, runs into Corradovo's, but would continue on without too much damage and would finish the race under power. Here's Ian Elias's view from the back of the pack. He made it to the green-white checkered despite having an alternate pit strategy following Robert Nelson there. Gets into Azzaretto and continues on without too much damage, trying to get around cars there on the outside as they pass him on the inside. Taking a look at the second incident here, Andy Lambert, and oh, that is a huge hit for Lazareva and Lambert, and that explains the smoke. Hopefully both of them are okay, because that was a huge incident reminiscent of Brian Gallagher's incident in race number one. Ingrid Hadeland caps off a strong run with a second place finish. Unfortunately, she couldn't catch Gaspar D'Souza as she was collected in the accident by Claire Aussier, who tagged the wall and pushed Hadeland into it early on in the green-white checker. Denny Adams caps off a very strong run as well, with a third place finish, and both D'Souza and Adams led 23 laps. So both get points for leading the most laps. Ian Elias, fourth place. Barry Juveno, Joe Craig, both managed to bring their cars home, fifth and sixth. Very good run for Juveno. He was very low in the points coming into this race and needed that finish. And Casey Lester was the final car to bring his car home in the green-white checkered in seventh place. A strong run for him. Yes, only seven cars finished the green-white checkered. Claire Aussier brought her car home in eighth, despite the smoke and that car breaking down on her after getting involved in that accident. Alina Lazareva, Ike Durbin, both did not bring their cars home after that due to quite a bit of damage you saw from Lazareva. Ike Durbin's car suffered quite a bit of damage and was unable to bring that car around. Andy Lambert earnharted the turn four wall, and no word on his medical condition. Hopefully he's fine. Frank Azzaretto, Robert Nelson, and Nicholas Corradovo's round out the green-white checkered finish. 15th through 20th did not advance due to the fact that they are one lap down. Pete Maverick gets his best finish of the season. He's been entirely anonymous this season and has not done anything worth of note up until this point. I believe this is his first top 20 of the season, so that just tells you how terrible he's been. John Jefferson brings the 0-4 team, the tumultuous 0-4 team, home in 16th place. Dan Lechleiter logged on to Skype and got in 17th place. Jacob Eichholz in 18th had an interesting pit strategy that didn't quite work out for him, as well as Ryan Jeffries, and Ramsey Cockener rounds out the top 20. And now, looking at the points, a new driver sits atop the point standings, and it is Laris Riu, the Indonesian Jet. Due to sneaking into the green-white checkered and getting a good finish, I believe she finished in fourth place in that green-white checkered that she probably should not have been in, but got in due to the failures of Silvio Rinaldi's fuel cell. Duncan Cobb moves up to second place, 3 points back from Laris Riu, and he continues his unlikely championship run. Ike Durbin moves up to third place, 7 points back. Silvio Rinaldi is up to fourth place. Ryan Griffin, fifth. Richard Dean MacGyver having a very good year this year, and he's in sixth place. Greg Maddox as well in seventh. Isaac Michaels moves up to eighth place. Dan Lechleiter in ninth, having a very strong run as well this year. But Stringfellow Vincent has dropped all the way down to 10th place in the standings from holding the championship lead after Road America. Alina Lazareva is in 11th. Scott Wallen having a strong run in 12th place this year. And Ben Atkins continues his free fall through the championship, In two races, he's dropped from 1st to 13th in the standings. Ingrid Hadeland up to 14th place with 169 points. Ben Worthington and Cameron Taylor are tied for 15th at 164 points. James Hewitt, the model of consistency, is in 17th place with 163 points, having a very good year, surprisingly. Kenny Steffens drops all the way down to 18th place from 6th in the standings after breaking down, and Alex Posington and Whitney Fuller are tied for 19th in the standings with 159 points apiece.